All right. Well, hey, church, we are in this series called Hey, Church. And so we've been in this, we've been talking about this for 3 weeks. We've got three more weeks to go, including today. And so what we've done is we've looked at this and we've looked at three different things so far. We're going to be looking at a fourth one today. We've looked at, from the very beginning, know your identity, that we would be people, we would stop and we would understand if we have a relationship with our Heavenly Father, that we're in His family, that we would know that that's our identity. We looked at this thing called, this is amazing grace, and really looking and seeing, if we could just begin to take time to focus on and see this thing called grace that God gives us, this unmerited, this undeserved kindness and favor, that it really is this amazing thing. Last week we talked about be bold, and we were talking about our boldness and the way that we would approach our Heavenly Father. And today we're going to talk about make a U-E. Make a U-E. So when I was thinking about this whole idea of making a U-E, I think we can all relate that I think that with little exception, that without one particular path or one particular place that we like to go to, that the shortest path is to go here, make a U-E, and come back, and then you're there. With the exception of that, most of us end up making a U-E because we were going the wrong way. Most of us make a U-E because we weren't paying attention and we passed where we were supposed to go, and so we have to end up doubling back, and we have to end up coming back, and we have to make a U-E. I was thinking about the most memorable U-E that I've ever made. And so it was actually several years ago that our family, we had vacationed to Ohio to go see some family. We had a friend with us that made the journey there and back, which made it easier because we had three drivers. And on our way back from Ohio, he had been driving, Cheryl had been sleeping, I had been sleeping, he was done. He pulled off, and I think it was into a gas station, and I ended up getting up and took over. So I got in the car behind the wheel, and I just started to drive. And as I started to drive, got back on the highway, and I'm headed home, and Cheryl got a little stirred. And I think she got stirred because I was behind the wheel. And she just knows that I am a terrible navigator. In fact, the rumor is that I can get lost using GPS, which is really not a rumor. I actually do. So even this last week, one of the staff members was telling one of our newest staff members, Jorge, hey, if you're ever going anywhere with Will and you have the opportunity to drive, take it. Don't ride with him. So anyways, back to Ohio, and I'm getting in the wheel, get behind the wheel. I'm starting to drive. I've been driving for a couple of minutes. Cheryl's getting a little stirred, and the next thing I know is she's asking me, do you know where you're going? Yes, I'm going home. She goes, do you know the way home? Yes. She says, home is south, not north. And so there I was trying to come home from Ohio. We'd already been making our journey. I get behind the wheel, and I get on the highway and start going north. 11 miles later, I finally had the opportunity to exit and turn around and make my way back. 11 miles. And I started thinking about that in our lives. And what came to mind was this, that I think that it's not uncommon for us that we finally get to a place where we understand where I'm headed in life, it's not the best option. This is not the best plan. This is not the best direction. And for some of us, it takes us a long time before we find an opportunity to turn around, before we get motivated enough to turn it around, to make that U-E. And that we, sometimes we can even get content going, you know, well, yeah, I probably really shouldn't be going this way, but it's kind of scenic, and I kind of like it, and I'm having fun anyways, and so I'll eventually get, and we do, we end up going the wrong way with our lives, and the longer we keep going down that path, the more time we've got to make up trying to come back and get back in the right direction. So we're going to be looking at this whole idea of make a U-E, and we're in this book of Ephesians. that the Apostle Paul, he's written this, he's written it to the people of Ephesus, he's written it to these people that they are believers, they are convinced of who Christ is, that they are followers of Christ, they're trying to grow in their relationship with him, they are making up the local church there, and he writes this letter to them, and he sends this out to them so that they would begin to understand, hey, here's some key things that you need to know and understand, and then here's how you need to live them out. And the first three chapters are all about this doctrinal truths, these things you need to know. And then the last three, we're going to get chapter four, so we're now going to be in this application. How do you apply this? How do you begin to live out what it is that I've been teaching you and I've been showing you and I've been making sure that you understand? So we're going to start in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1. I hope you've got your Bible with you, electronic or printed. You're going to get this out and you're going to follow along. But we're going to start Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1. Therefore, here's Paul halfway through this letter and he starts it off here with therefore. Now, one of the things that I was taught when I was being trained for ministry is that whenever you see a therefore, you need to stop and ask, what's it there for? What's it there for? And you've got to understand, there's some context that you have to grasp and take hold of if you're going to understand where they're going to go from that point forward. So you have to know where you've been. And again, Paul, he's already been writing. He's been saying, hey, know your identity. He's already been writing, hey, this is this grace thing. It's amazing. And just describing it and teaching on it. And then he's been teaching on this idea of be bold. Be bold in your approach to your Heavenly Father. That don't be timid and have these weak knees to where you don't get on your knees and don't spend time in prayer and being bold in the way that you come to him. But you need to be bold. You need to be confident. You need to trust that God is there for you. That every believer should approach God with boldness and with confidence. That we should be bold in knowing that God wants to hear from us. God wants us to interact with him. And that we would be bold in how we do that. Even when we've stumbled back into sin, even when we're living life, we're going, I just don't even know if I can even find any kind of hope or any kind of traction. He wants us to be bold in the way that we would approach him. And a bold faith makes our faith stronger. It stretches our faith. And yet a timid faith, it makes our faith weaker. It shrinkens our faith. And so we need to be people that we are going to be bold. That Paul even spent some time letting the church know that he was praying for him. He says, I pray for you and I pray that you would experience God's unlimited resources. That you would experience this as he gives them to you and that you would be empowered by Christ. And as you're empowered by him, that you would receive this inner strength that would come from the Spirit. These are things that we need to know for this therefore that Paul is going to get to. That he said to us, he says, Christ will make his home in our hearts when we trust him. That's what he's going to do. When we trust him, he's going to make his home in our hearts. Because that's what Jesus wants to do. And he says, and may your roots grow down deep into God's love. May your roots grow down deep into God's love that would keep you strong. And as your roots grow down, the fruits grow up. And so that we would do this. And what we have these benefits of having a faith that is bold, these benefits that come from being bold in the way that we would approach our Heavenly Father. That it gives us this benefit that when we are going through these tough times, the tough times are viewed as opportunities for growth. That these tough times, we're all going to go through tough times. And that tough times, when we're bold in our approach to God, they can be seen as these are opportunities for me to grow. For me to grow closer to God as I depend on him to get through this time. For me to grow as a person, for me to grow as an individual, for me to begin to see that God's going to work everything out. He is sovereign, and it is an opportunity for us to grow. So Ephesians 4:1, therefore. Let's grab three verses from chapter 3. Let's look at these and get the rest of this context, starting in verse 19 of chapter 3. Paul writes and he says, "May you experience the love of Christ, though it is too great to fully understand." May you experience it, but you have to know it's too great to fully understand it. "Then you will be made complete with all the fullness of life and power that comes from God. Now all glory to God, who is able through his mighty power at work within us to accomplish infinitely more than we might ask or think." This should be really good news for all of us here. That especially for those of you that you sometimes that you feel like, "I just don't pray well enough, and it's my prayer life that's my problem, and that's why my life is so difficult and hard, is because I'm just not praying the right way." I don't want to minimize prayer in any way, shape, or form. And so what I'm saying here is not saying, "Hey, don't even pray, don't even bother." Prayer is the way that we connect and we commune with our Heavenly Father, and He absolutely wants to hear from us, and it's a way for us to stop, get quiet with our lives, and even allow God to begin to speak to us, speak to our hearts. But when we pray, it's this connection with God. But don't feel like that, you know, if I didn't pray it just the right way and I didn't pray long enough doing this, then God's not going to do it. No, He is able to do infinitely more than we might ask or even think. That He's going to do things for our lives that we didn't even think about asking Him to be able to do for us. Because He cares about us, loves us that much. He's not a God that's going, "Well, I'm just kind of waiting for you to say the words. And when you say it, I'll find, okay, just say." He is a God who loves us. And He's able to do infinitely more than what we might ask or think. Verse 21, "Glory to Him in the church and in Christ Jesus through all generations forever and ever. Amen." Get back to this, "Therefore. Therefore, I, a prisoner for serving the Lord, beg you to lead a life worthy of your calling." Who's he writing to? He's writing to the church. When he's writing to the church, whenever we see this in our New Testament, the church was always made up of believers. It's unlike when we just come in and gather into church. We're not necessarily, everybody here is convinced of who Christ is. And that's a good thing. And we are certainly glad that you are here, that if you're going, "Hey, I'm not sure what I believe yet. I don't even know what I need to know, but I'm here and I just want to see what you have to offer. What is it that you would say so that I could begin to process this and understand and see if this Jesus thing is for me?" We are glad you are here. But when we are reading in our Bibles and we read church, it is always going to be referring to those who believe. And so he's writing to them and he's saying, "Hey, those of you that you have experienced this calling," maybe a better way for us to understand it would be that you are somebody who you have answered the call. That God was calling you and God wanted you and you answered that call and you began a relationship with Him. And this is what Paul wants us to know. He says, "So I beg you to lead a life worthy of your calling." You've been called, you've answered, you are now in a relationship with your Heavenly Father. And lead a life worthy of being in His family. Lead a life worthy of being in that relationship. That's what he wants us to do. Verse 2, "Always be humble and gentle." Now, there might be some of you guys in the room that you see this word "always," and you're like, get all timid. "Oh, I hate those extreme words. I never listen to extreme words." Well, that's kind of a bold response for somebody that would say, "Hey, I'm not going to follow these words like always." But here he is, and he's wanting us, he's emphasizing, what is it that we need to be doing? What is it that we need to be striving to do? What is it that we need to be doing? If we're awake, if we're interacting with people, what should we be? Humble and gentle. That if we're just having our own little thoughts and thinking about our own lives and who we are, what do we need to be? We need to be humble. Always be humble and gentle. And I think there's an extreme value here that humility and gentleness could prevent most of our relational conflicts. Humility and gentleness could prevent most of our relational conflicts. I want you to think back to a recent conflict. Hopefully that's not a couple of minutes ago for most of you. But as you think back to a relational conflict, and that there was some tension, and it was kind of thick, and some of you you're already upset with me. You're like going, Will, this is my safe place. This is my happy place. And you're not supposed to bring things up that makes me think about what was going wrong with my life. I'm escaping when I'm here. Well, I don't want this to be your escape place. I want this to be your growth place. And even if you're somebody that you're going, I'm not even sure what I believe about Jesus. Listen, if you'll begin to put into practice these very things that we get to learn from God's word, and if you would just begin to trust these and put these into practice and see how it improves your life, it's going to build trust between you and God's word. And here Paul says, always, always be humble and gentle. And if you think back to a recent conflict, I want to ask you a question. If all the parties involved, maybe it was just two, maybe it was more, I don't know. But if all of the parties involved would have handled themselves and the issue, would have handled themselves, you, and the issue with humbleness and gentleness, do you think things would have turned out differently? Because chances are they would have. And here's Paul. He's wanting us to know always, always be humble and gentle. Be patient with each other, making allowance for each other's faults, because of your love. So I was a youth pastor for several years before I became a lead pastor. And one of the things that would often happen is that teenagers would open up and have conversations. Sometimes it was in the group. Many times it was just kind of one-on-one. And they would open up, and they would open up to me, and they would open up about this problem. And I found that there was this central theme that it didn't matter which teenager I was talking to, what their socioeconomic background was, what side of town they lived on, how many parents they lived with, blended family, not blended, that part didn't matter. But they had this one thing that kept coming up, and it was a central theme, a central thread of what was going on whenever they would talk about the issues. And the issues would always circle back to and often come back to this thing that they had in their lives that you might have heard of them before, but they're called parents. And that some of their frustration, some of their anger, some of their issues would keep circling back around to these things called parents. And they would just say things like this: my parents just expect me to be perfect. I'm not. That we as parents, we don't expect our kids to be perfect, but we definitely want to hold them accountable and help them get to a place where we think they're capable of being. But as they would be there, they just go, my parents, they just expect me to be perfect, and it makes so much tension, and they're so frustrated. And then some of you teenagers are like going, hey, preach it, Will, I like this. But let me finish, then you won't like me so much. And what I would share with them, as I would share with them, I think the very issue that you have right now is the very thing that you think your parents have against you. To see, for you, the reason that you have so much animosity or anger towards your parents right now is because you yourself are expecting them to be perfect. And they're not. And you end up having this family dynamic sometimes where each other's expecting the other one to be perfect, but wants complete permission in themselves to go, but I'm not perfect. And see, none of us are. And so Paul tells us, we need to make allowances for each other's faults. Because we're all going to have these faults. So as we begin to live out these things that we've learned and about this love that we're supposed to have, this love that we have because Christ is in us, and while we are carrying the kind of love that he has for people. Verse 3, make every effort to keep yourselves united in the Spirit, binding yourselves together with peace. To remain united, to always be connected with the Holy Spirit, that you're living your life in such a way that you're allowing God to work in you. It requires effort to be united with the Spirit. Because see, if the Spirit's over here and we intentionally come over here, then we're living with the Spirit, yes. And every day, that's a daily decision, because there is some kind of magnetic pull. There is this natural drift that if we just keep going and living our lives without being intentional, we will drift. There's this magnetic pull that pulls us away. And so we have to be intentional on choosing to be united with the Spirit in the way that we are living out our lives. For there is one body and one Spirit, just as you have been called to the one glorious hope for the future. That there's one body, that's the body of Christ, the body of believers. There's one Spirit, the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit. And there's one hope, the hope that we're going to one day be in heaven and be with God for all of eternity because of His incredible grace that we have received. Well, let's jump to verse 11. Now, these are the gifts Christ gave to the church. These are the gifts. Here's one thing that I know about gifts. I know that it is great to give gifts, and I know that it's great to receive gifts. That there's something special about having somebody in your life that you love so much that there's going to be something that you're going to recognize them for, and you're going to go out of your way to get a gift for them. And there's certainly something about being on the receiving end of a gift as well. That gifts are great, no matter whether you're on the giving end or whether you're on the receiving end. And Christ has given some gifts to the church. And so we've got some gifts in here that show what He has given. So He's given this gift right here, that He's given the gift of apostles. And apostles, they're the early church leaders that began the movement of the church. That He gave this gift to the church, these apostles. That He also gave this gift to the church, and this gift is prophets. And what are prophets? Prophets are either forth-tellers or foretellers. They're either forth-telling, so they're just speaking the truth and getting the truth out there, or they're foretellers, and they're telling, hey, this is going to happen. God has revealed this, and this is what's going to take place. And again, we can read throughout our Bible where we had these prophets that God had given so that we could begin to trust Him and know that He is the Almighty One. That what we have with the church is we've been given this gift right here, that we've been given the gift of evangelists. That evangelists have been given to the church. And this gift is to the church. And what are these evangelists? These evangelists, they're the ones that they passionately are going out and they are sharing the love of Christ with people with no excuse, with no shame, and just getting this word and this message out and letting people know that God loves you and He wants to have a relationship with you. And they're pushing this, and it's a gift to the church. And then there's this gift right here that I really kind of like this gift. I'm a little close to that one right there. That there's the gift of pastors, and pastors are the shepherds to the church, that they oversee the flock. And then we have this gift of teachers. The teachers that are the ones that are making sure that the Word of God is being understood correctly and teaching that and spreading that throughout the believers. That these are the gifts that have been given to the church, the apostles, the prophet, the evangelists, the pastors, and teachers. Verse 12, their responsibility is, because see, He's saying, hey, these gifts, they have a responsibility. They have to do something for the church because they're a gift to the church, and they have to do something for the church, and their responsibility is to equip God's people to do His work and build up the church, the body of Christ. That the gifts have to do what? They have to come along and they have to equip God's people. What are they supposed to equip God's people to do? To do God's work. That Paul is teaching us that it's not that these gifts are supposed to do all of the work and all of the ministry. What these gifts are supposed to do to the church, the body of believers, is they're supposed to equip them so that the believers get to do the ministry, that the believers get to do God's work. This is this gift. And when we look at this gift and we begin to understand this gift, that we have these apostles and we have the prophets and we have the evangelists and we have the pastors and we have the teachers, that these gifts, that if you're a believer, they're given to you. This is who they're given to. They're given to you. Why? To equip you so that you can do God's work. I love the way we have people that volunteer around here at Crosspoint. That we absolutely could not do the ministry and have the impact that we have without the volunteers giving of themselves and saying, hey, I'll come in, I'll serve, I'll do. I'm available. I want to. I'm willing. And if you're not currently volunteering, and if you were to have a conversation with somebody who is volunteering, and if you were just to ask, hey, you know, how are you guys doing where you're volunteering? You know, whether we're talking about office staff, whether we're talking about Wednesday Night Unite program, whether we're talking about our journey team, community group ministries, whether we're talking about our Sunday morning ministries, whatever we're talking about. And if you were to begin to have a conversation with them and you were to ask them, hey, how are you doing with that, all that? You know, you guys good? Could you guys use anybody else? You're going to see them begin to salivate. Are you interested? Because we could really use some help. Because all of them, they're going, hey, we're doing it, we're pouring it out, but we know we really could use more people. We don't have any ministry that's overstaffed. We have ministries that are understaffed. And we're doing something that we just recently started last month called Monthly Morning Momentum. And we're doing something that's great for the 11 o'clock crowd. We're giving you a reason to get up early on Sundays. Because at 8:22 next Sunday morning, the first Sunday of the month, we're doing our Monthly Morning Momentum. And who's that for? It's for current volunteers, and it's for people that are going, hey, you know what, I'd be interested in volunteering. I'd like to find a path. Where is it that I could be used, and where is it I could be serving? It's for both groups. That's who it's for. What are we doing with that? We're using it to equip and encourage you. That is the sole purpose of coming together. We're going to feed you breakfast, and then we're going to equip you, we're going to encourage you, and if you're not currently volunteering, we're going to help you find a path so that you can begin to volunteer. Because see, my role and the role of our other pastors that's a gift to you is to equip you. And if you're not currently volunteering, we'd love for you to come and to be our guest and come to our Monthly Morning Momentum next Sunday morning. Well, let's get to the heart of where I get the title, Make a Ewe. Verse 17. Paul here is offering a spiritual map and saying, hey, if you need to know where you need to be headed, here it is. Verse 17, with the Lord's authority, I say this, live no longer as the Gentiles do, for they are hopelessly confused. They're the Gentiles. Who's he talking about when he says the Gentiles? He's specifically talking about there was Jews and there was Gentiles. You were either a Jew or you were a Gentile. That everything was categorized into those two groups. And if you were a Gentile, he's categorizing the Gentiles as those that didn't even know that Jesus came for them, that Jesus wants to have a relationship with them. And he's just stereotyping all of these Gentiles together here. For they are hopelessly confused. Verse 18, their minds are full of darkness, and they wander far from the life that God gives because they have closed their minds and hardened their hearts against him. This isn't that God said, hey, I'm gonna harden your heart. No, these are individuals that have said, I've kind of got my heart hardened, and I'm just kind of living my life for myself, and I'm trying to achieve everything I can on my own, and who needs God? And they've done this, and they've hardened their mind. And so here's where we begin to see where Paul wants us to make a Ewe. Don't live like them. Don't live like somebody that has no hope. Don't live like somebody who's just kind of finding yourself just kind of wandering around because you don't know what you're supposed to be doing. Verse 19, they have no sense of shame. They have no sense of shame. You need to have a sense of shame when you're doing what's wrong. That you need to make a Yui. That what do you need? You need to make a Yui. Look at this. They live for lustful pleasure and eagerly practice every kind of impurity. With eagerly practice it. What do they need to do? If this is what they're doing, they need to make a Yui. See, but that isn't what you learned about Christ. Since you have heard about Jesus and have learned the truth that comes from him, throw off your old sinful nature, your former way of life, which is corrupted by lust and deception. What's he saying? Make a Yui. Verse 23, instead, let the Spirit renew your thoughts and attitudes. Put on your new nature, created to be like God. Well, what way am I created to be like God? Truly righteous and holy. This righteous, to live in a right standing with God. That we're created to live righteously and holy. Holy, this set apart for a purpose. Holy, and the purpose is to be set apart for God. That we would do this. Verse 25, stop telling lies. Let us tell our neighbors the truth, for we are all parts of the same body. And don't sin by letting anger control you. Anger. Anger in and of itself is not sin. It's what we do with our anger that determines whether or not it is sin. That if in our anger we use that and we let that kind of fire us up and we begin to belittle people or hurt people, whether it's emotionally or physically, whether we begin to spread the rumors of it, however it is, when we do that with anger, that's sin. And so we can be angry and not sin. And so he's telling us, and don't sin by letting anger control you. So what do I have to do? I have to make a Yui if anger tends to control me. I need to make a Yui. I need to not let it control me. Don't let the sun go down while you are still angry. Now we've got some people that might be a little OCD, and you might get a verse like this, and somebody might get angry with you, and you might have a watch like mine that tells you what time the sunset is. And it's for you to look at that and you to tell them, you got about 4 more minutes. And you gotta be done with that. So get it all out of you, but the timer started, buddy. And that's not really what Paul's getting at. He's saying, let this day end and let your anger end with it. When this day ends, you need to let go of that anger. Don't carry that anger into future days. Why? For anger gives a foothold to the devil. And if he can get a foothold and he can find a way in, he's going to hang out and he's going to do all sorts of relational destruction. If you are a thief, quit stealing. You need to make a Yui. If you're a thief, quit stealing, make a Yui. Instead, use your hands for good, hard work. And then give generously to others in need. Just make a Yui. If you haven't caught this yet with this make a Yui, I hope you're seeing this. Because every time Paul is saying, hey, if this is you, then instead of, now start. So if you're stealing, if you're a thief, make a Yui. And the Yui isn't, well, it's not come to a stop and just stop stealing. No, make a Yui. Work with your hands. Earn what it is that you need to earn. That if you're chasing after lustful things, then stop and make a Yui. Don't just stop and start pursuing what is holy and wholesome. That it's not just stop, but it's make a Yui. And for some of you, you've been looking at this list so far, and you're like going, I'm safe. I'm doing good. Well, we're not done. Verse 29, don't use foul or abusive language. I just caught a bunch of you. don't use this foul or this abusive language. So what am I do? You make a Yui. Well, how do you make a Yui? This way. Let everything you say be good and helpful, so that your words will be an encouragement to those who hear them. So instead of being abusive with what you're saying or being foul, make a Yui and now encourage people. Verse 30. And do not bring sorrow to God's Holy Spirit by the way that you live. Remember, He has identified you as His own, guaranteeing that you will be saved on the day of redemption. That if you're in this relationship with your Heavenly Father, you're being saved from the penalty of your sin, and you're going to be saved into this right relationship with God, where you're going to be able to spend an eternity with Him. Last two verses. Get rid of all bitterness, rage, anger, harsh words, and slander, as well as, and this is kind of like the, in case I missed it, as well as all types of evil behavior. Get rid of it. Make a Yui. Okay, well, what's making a Yui look like? Instead, be kind to each other, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, just as God, through Christ, has forgiven you. Once you know your identity, once you've experienced this amazing grace, once you begin to find this traction in being bold in your approach to your Heavenly Father, be prepared to make a Yui. Because God's got an incredible plan for your life. And that plan is a plan where you're going to experience, get to experience His best. And when we begin to move in a direction that's not toward His best, even if we find ourselves being content there for a little while, we're going to find that that road is a very hard road. And it's going to leave us and beat us up and leave us with a lot of scars. And we need to make a Yui. And we need to get back on what God's best path for us is. Pray with me. God, I pray that we would welcome Your Spirit convicting us. That would be our prayer, that Heavenly Father, would Your Spirit convict us of where we're moving in the wrong direction with our lives, with our attitudes, with our actions. Would You convict us? And help us to make this Yui, to turn our life around and start moving in the direction that is Your best for us. Jesus, I pray that we would be able to experience Your best because we would be listening and we would follow Your lead. It's in Your name we pray. Amen.